Let's have a word of prayer. I need it. Father, we thank you so much for another opportunity to come together to open your word and to hear what you have to say to us. Guide us, grant us understanding. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay. I apologize for not having new material printed up for you. We'll get that next time, and I'll get all that printed out. But I've got some neat-looking charts that I think you will that will help you understand. It gives a breakdown of the seals and the order and all that good stuff. Anyway, yeah, just a whole bunch of stuff that I'm going to hand out a little at a time, not all of it at once, but anyway. Tonight, though, I'm having to use my laptop because I couldn't print. I forgot we had changed our password on our... It's all right for your camera. I switched it on yours, but I forgot to switch it on the printers. And since they're wireless, then I couldn't hook up to them and couldn't print. Anyway, so tonight we're going to be talking about the seven seals that are mentioned in Revelation, I think...
six.
Yeah, six verses. We'll start off with verse 1 and 2 on that. The seven seals represent events to take place on this earth during the seals' specific period of time. Now, each one represents a period of time, beginning at the time of Christ and continuing until Christ's second coming. Wish I could show you this neat little picture that I got here, but that'll be next time. You'll see it. We will have over the seven seals, we have the white horse, the red horse, and the black horse. And those three we're going to talk about tonight. And then we'll pick up the pale horse. We'll talk about the souls that are crying out. That's the fifth seal. The sixth seal will be earthquakes. They'll talk about earthquakes, sun, moon, and stars. And then the seventh seal talks about silence in heaven. Okay? So, kind of a quick review of things. The whole book of Revelation is the last book in the New Testament, the revelation of Jesus Christ, not of John on that. Now he gave this to his servant John and told him to record it and write it down. A great many of Revelation's prophecies have already been fulfilled, and history bears record of that as we look at them. Some of them are now in the process of being fulfilled, and others are still in the future. Most of these important prophecies of the Bible are in figurative language so they might be understood, I guess, equally well over time. If it's described in one time frame how people perceive things, and then you get into another and they perceive it a little bit differently, then evidently that's what this writer here is suggesting, that that's why the Lord used the descriptions of Revelation the way he did, so it could pass through the different time zones and as people studied them. There's still a lot of question up in the air exactly to what they all specifically mean. You see different interpretations and translations of what all this means, and we're going to try to get as much of it understood to the best of our abilities or that we can here on that. So the seven seals are found in Revelation chapter 5, 6, and 8. Each of the seven seals is broken, and a picture of representation of the events that take place on earth during that period of time that the seal is referencing. Now, who can open the seal? Okay? It starts off, it says, nobody can open the seal. And then we see that Christ opens the seal. Okay? The Lamb of God takes the book and opens the seven seals one by one. Let's see. Revelation chapter 5, verse 9 says, "And they sang a new song, saying, and you are worthy to take the scroll and to open the seals. And you were slain and have redeemed us to God by your blood out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation." Okay? The supreme power that we see here of all of the universe is the Lamb of God who died for us. In Him, we see infinite power in self-sacrifice. We also find out as we study the Bible that Lucifer, when he was in heaven, he sought power himself. He wanted it all for himself. He wanted to be God. And because of that, then he tried to defeat God, and he got thrown out of heaven. But Jesus, as we study his life, we see that he humbled himself and was awarded the exaltation that Satan wanted but didn't get. Jesus came to save the lost and to glorify the Father. And by faith, then we see we see what has happened, and we see how Christ gave Himself for us. And by faith, we believe in Him and we trust in Him, and we give Him the honor and the adoration that is worthy Him. And because of what He did, then He was worthy to open this seven sealed seals of the book. Okay, so the first seal is the white horse, has a subtitle of bow and crown. Okay? Yeah, it's in the handout. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I showed that to him a while ago, pointed that out a while ago. You're confirming that. Okay. Okay, now, let me mention one thing. I think week before last or whatever, I was so frustrated with things that were in the studying and everything that I made a statement later that I thought that was dumb and stupid. So I need to correct that statement and let you know that the seals that we're talking about, the seven seals, are in the tribulation time frame. Okay? All right. I think I made the statement that I didn't know when they were. but that's when they are. So anyway, just let you know that was wrong, but they are in that time frame of the 7-year period of tribulation.
I have here, I've written down here, 2nd 3.5.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, you have the 1st 3.5 and the 2nd 3.5 on that. So anyway, as the Savior breaks the first seal of the book of Revelation, or the book that holds the seals, rather, we see John began to react to it. He says, "And I looked, and behold, a white horse. He who sat on it had a bow, and a crown was given to him. And he went out conquering and to conquer." That's the second verse of Revelation 6, okay? Now, these seals cover 7 eras of time frame, as I mentioned a while ago, from the time of the apostles to the second coming of our Lord Jesus. And to a large event, they depict religious affairs in the world that are going on. And as we look at this, we will see a correlation. We'll begin to pick out on that, well, wow, I can see how some of this is a reality today and how it could wind up the way it is. So in the first seal, we see Christ with the wreath of a conqueror. He rides the white horse, white being this the emblem of victory and also of purity. The prophetic picture shows the apostolic church led by its divine captain to victory over a pagan world and over the doctrines and teachings of the pagan world. And we see that Christ himself is the victorious leader. Now, as the Apostle Paul exclaimed in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, we see that Paul saw that the pure gospel was transforming men. And he says in that verse, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes, the Jew first and also the Greek." Now, white is a symbol of purity. In the apostolic age, the doctrine of life and life of the church was pure, and under the leadership of Christ and the apostles who were alive at that day, it went forth victoriously, carrying the gospel to the entire civilized world in that generation, the world that they knew of at that time, okay? Now, understand, that was a world that didn't have railroads. That was the world that didn't have internet, and we have to worry about these wires and getting everything, or passwords, so we can hook up to the printer and print what we want. That world didn't have highways. They didn't have space travel or anything like that. They didn't even have the Gutenberg press at that time. Nothing on that. They didn't have TV. So the first gospel that was presented then had to be carried by individuals to the whole civilized world and over the next few years. And as the Apostle Paul said, it was preached to every creature under heaven in Colossians chapter 1, verse 23. So the gospel of Jesus Christ was pure at that time, while the apostles was presenting it and carrying it out and making sure that it got out. One reason the church was pure during that time period was that it was busy about caring for others, doing for others, working for others. The church that is busy working for others and caring for others is a church that will stay out of trouble. But when we begin to look at ourselves and we start thinking about, well, I wouldn't do that. How come I didn't get called or picked to do that? And we begin to look at inward at ourselves rather than focusing on taking the gospel, the truth of Jesus Christ to others, then we see that's when the church begins to get into trouble. It's when the members settle down to enjoy religion for themselves along with the troubles of others and themselves. That's where we begin to lose sight. This writer here, he said that if the pastor does not watch out, they will keep him so busy settling and putting out fires, that the affairs that keep coming up, that he will never get out to the lost sheep at all. So we've got to be careful. We've got to make sure that we keep the focus on the focus and not, which is Jesus Christ, the main focus, and not start looking around at other things on that. After the apostles died, a change came. Faith grew cold, and the predicted days of falling away, as Paul said in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3, that began to happen. And we see the next seal then flashes a sad picture on the scene of prophecy. So the second seal now is the red horse, okay? And the subtitle for that is a great sword. Now, the verse on that is chapter 6, verses 3 and 4. When he opened, and this is a capital H, remember, Christ is the one that opens the seals. When he opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature saying, "Come and see." Another horse, fiery red, went out, and it was granted to the one who sat on it to take peace from the earth, and that people should kill one another. And there was given to him a great sword. You may.
I think you said something a while ago that confused me, and I'm going to go back.
Okay.
You said the white horse represented Christ. I thought it was the Antichrist.
No. It's Christ riding the horse. The white horse.
He's wearing a crown.
He's wearing the.
Okay.
The,
are we in chapter 6?
Yes.
Verse 1. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So if it says that the white horse and he, not a capital H, and he who sat on,
well,
it had a bow and a crown. The crown was given to him.
Okay.
And he, little H, went out conquering it.
Yeah. You're right. I'm glad you picked up on that.
Because I was a little confused because we talked about it last week.
Okay.
It said,
yeah.
The Antichrist.
Now I saw when the Lamb opened the seals that I heard one fourth. Oh, this is one of the living creatures saying with a loud thunder, "Come and see." I looked up and behold a white horse. Now this one, okay. No. Okay. He who sat on it had a bow and a crown that was given to him, which is a little H. Okay. And he went out conquering. Okay. You're right.
I think maybe one point, it talks about the Lamb is the one that's opening the seals, and the Lamb is capital L-A-M-B, that is Jesus Christ. So Christ is opening the seals. So he's still
That's okay.
Yeah, and on the second one here, it references that it's another horse, a fiery red went out, and it was granted to the one who sat on it, okay? Meaning it was not Christ, okay, that sat on that. Okay, thank you for picking up on that.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. That was not Christ that was riding the horse, okay.
Because the red horse represents.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
I think we had talked last week.
On the white horse
was Antichrist because he gained the peace.
This does not say that. No, this is one of the. Do what?
It just says in one of them.
One of the creatures.
Yeah, one of the creatures. The second living creature saying, come. And another red horse went out.
Well, it talked about the bow.
Yeah.
There was no arrow. There was a false
peace.
Okay, okay. Right. But look, Warren Wiersbe says in chapter 6, verses 3 and 4, Antichrist's conquest begins in peace, but soon he exchanges the empty bow for a sword. The color red is often associated with terror and death.
Yeah.
The dragon, the red beast, it pictures wanton bloodshed. The color black is often connected with famine during the
Okay.
Yeah.
And this is what I'm understanding from reading my Bible. It says, I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures saying with a voice like thunder, come and see. Mm-hmm. And he says, and I looked, and behold. So I'm thinking the creature called John over
to come and see. Yeah. Yeah.
So I don't think it's the creature that was
on that. Let me get more clarification on that for next week. But in the studying that I've done, does not address that specifically. It says, now when I saw the Lamb opened one of the seals, I heard one of the four living creatures saying with a voice like thunder, come and see. And I looked. So it says for him to come and see, yeah, for John. And I looked, and behold, a white horse, he sat on it. He who sat on it had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he went out conquering and to conquer.
Okay, it says the four, and here it says the four horses and their riders do not represent specific individuals, but horses. Some, however, identify this rider with the Antichrist.
Yeah. I'm thinking we have the four horses, and it talks about four creatures on that. So I'm thinking each one of the creatures is on the horse. Let me look a little bit further into that.
But it's not Christ.
It's not Christ.
Okay,
no.
That was where I was trying to clarify.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
On chapter verse 4, and there went out another horse. That was red.
And yeah, that's
was given to him the little H.
Yeah, that's where I am now. Is on that, on that.
Peace from the earth and the kill. So that had to be Satan, because God wouldn't.
Well, simply because it's red, we don't know. Red does not necessarily associate.
It doesn't imply that at all.
On that. But it says in the version I got here, it says, when he opened the second seal, I heard the second living creature saying, come and see. Another horse, fiery red, went out. And it was granted to the one who sat on it to take peace from the earth and that people should kill one another. And there was given to him a great sword. Okay, that's verses 3 and 4. Now, white, it's not donate, designates, victory, okay, and purity, let me get that off of there, okay, and purity, the color is changed to red. The red horse represents bloodshed.
Okay.
okay? Not Satan, but bloodshed, okay? The days we see here from the death of the apostles to the exaltation of the worldly church by the great Emperor Constantine depicts the time of the pagan persecutions that come about. So we see that from what I am getting out of this, we see that the white horse, the first seal and the second seal, that has happened, okay? Because of the white horse, the purity that was there, referencing the apostles kept the church pure, and when they died, then that's when the worldlism and paganism and all of that began to creep into the teachings of the church. Constantine was the first emperor that actually recognized Christianity on that. And he had his whole army baptized except for the sword arm. That was interesting. Get your soul saved here, but keep your arm out there because we want you to go out and kill the bad people. So. Anyway, I've always thought that was interesting that he did that. Now, Nero, you remember what he did? He caused the great fire of Rome, and he blamed the Christians. And the slaughter of Christians began to happen with them. Many of the Christians found refuge in the catacombs under the Roman or Rome itself, the town Rome, they begin to hide there. But when one Christian was killed and martyred, there was always another that would come in and take their place and keep the gospel going on that. The martyrs of Jesus loved not their lives unto death, Revelation 12, verse 11. That. Now, remember, red is an appropriate color, I guess we could say, of this time frame, of this period of time under the emperors and under all of the slaughtering and everything. There was persecution like you wouldn't believe unless you've actually read the history of what some of it was. They would gather up Christians and they would impale them, soak them in oil, and use them for torches for their parties and things of that nature. They would take the babies of the Christians and slaughter them in front of them. Throw them onto a hot skillet alive and kill them that way. And then they would starve animals for days and then put the Christians out in the middle of the arena and release the animals, and they'd go out and just slaughter men, women, and children on that. They were killed by the thousands at that time. So it was an awful, awful time. Those who professed the name of Christ were sometimes tortured to try to make them to denounce Christ on that. So it was an awful time. Whenever any great natural calamity occurred, it was always blamed on the Christians. And they'd be the ones that the mobs would go after. But because of that, believe it or not, Christianity prospered and it grew. Pretty much like what has happened in China. The underground church has grown unbelievably strong because of the communist rule and trying to squelch out the life of the Word of God at that time. In 2001, when PK and I were privileged to go to Hong Kong and to be a part of a witnessing team, we had some of the Chinese people that lived in Hong Kong and on the mainland. They would come together and we worshiped at Kowloon City Baptist Church, and they would tell us of how the underground church was growing and what all was happening there. And that. So we can see that today in our world around us, where there's so many people that are being tortured in other parts of the world. You referenced that in your mission story this morning in Africa. And our missionary family that's lived over there has referenced that it's pretty bad. In fact, at one time when they lived in the Congo, wasn't it? Rich?
In the Congo.
They lived over there, and they had to be extremely careful about what they said and who they talked to, because of the danger that was there on that. So it's still alive today, but praise the Lord, I don't think it's as bad as what the Bible describes here in that time frame. Okay, now the black horse is the third seal. The third seal was broken, and the apostle says, when he opened the third seal, I heard the third living creature say, come and see. So I looked, and behold, a black horse, and he who sat on it had a pair of scales in his hands. Verses 5 and 6. Now, this is a little bit different picture that we look at here. The color black implies departure from the purity of Christ. It implies death, represented by the white horse of a conquering apostolic church. We see black signifying the sadness and the darkness of the age at that time. We see that there is scarcity of bread, representing spiritual food, and scarcity of the Word of God, meaning the depravity of the Word of God itself, not being able to be shared as much. The Apostle Paul has foretold, in Acts chapters 20, in verses 29 and 30, where he says, for I know this, that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. Also from among yourselves, men will rise up, speaking perverse things to draw away from the disciples after themselves. So we see that because the Word of God has been preached and taught to the degree that it is, we see now that Satan is coming in his slick, sly way of trying to cut down everything that's been built up and produced. I think because of our effort as a church in praying every night at 9 o'clock, seeking the covering of the Holy Spirit upon us, seeking the power of the Spirit to fall upon us, seeking the convicting power of the Spirit of God to be brought upon us as individuals, in order that the power of Christ may be manifested more through this body. I see that where We have experienced some attack from all of this, from some of the graffiti stuff that was put on our church and all. And I fear that if we're not careful within ourselves, we're going to start looking at ourselves rather than at Christ, and we're going to get our feelings hurt. And what I preached about this morning on forgiveness, being forgiven, is going to be hard for us to do because we lose focus of our purpose. We lose focus of what Christ is wanting us to do in the job that we have before us. So we've got to be careful. We must continue to seek after the anointing power of the Holy Spirit of God in order that we may continue to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. But we've got to be on our toes at the same time and not allow Satan to sneak in and cause hard feelings and hurt feelings to happen and all. So that's one of the things that I've been praying for, that God would protect us from that as he continues to bring us in closer fellowship with him. Because the closer we are with him, then the more power we will see his power, let me say, the more of his power we'll see through this body reaching out into this community. we see that for the next 200 years that there was a great departure from the pure gospel and truth, widespread teachings of paganism and philosophy and all. And all of this began to creep into the church. We look back at history, we see how the church, the Church of England, the Roman Church, Catholic Church, how they began to think that they were the authority of God. And we see how they began to create a separation of God from the purpose of what God had for the church in the first place. We see the philosophies changing. We see liberalism beginning to come in. We see paganism being absorbed into the church itself and watering down the gospel. We see churches today, denominations, that have homosexual pastors, homosexual deacons, that nowhere in the Word of God do you find that sanctioned in any way, form, or fashion. It's the infiltrating philosophy of the paganistic beliefs of this world that's beginning to creep into religion today. Not Christianity. That's not in Christianity, but it happens in religions today. Remember, white stands for purity, red bloodshed, black stands for spiritual darkness and apostasy. Now, this apostasy was in the church from about the 3rd century on down until about the 6th century when the church state authority was established in 538. Of this time, historian, a church historian by the name of Philip Schaff, S-C-H-A-F-F, he said that the elevation of Christianity as the religion of the state involved great risk of spiritual degeneration to the church. And that's what we need to be careful of. So as we study these seals as they're opened and as we see what's happening, we need to stop and we need to look at ourselves today. Where are we today in this cycle? Are we back in the first seal cycle? Are we in the second seal cycle? Or do we find ourselves paganized as a church? We find ourselves in that third seal of apostasy and all. We need to be very, very careful, because many of these ancient doctrines, people are pulling them back up and they're saying they're going back to them and trying to get them involved and get them back into the churches and what is believed as a part of the original Christianity teaching, of which they're not. We need, traditions are good, but we don't want to let a tradition become our idol and worship the tradition rather than what is the truth that was behind that tradition of doing that in the first place. In summary, in many things during this time, the traditions of men began to take the place of the Bible, and the power of the emperor that had often interfered in the affairs of the church and began to tear down the structure and the foundation of Christianity on that. I'm going to stop there tonight. We'll pick up with the fourth seal, the pale horse, next time. And the subtitle for that is Death and Hades on that. And that represents dark times. So we just talked about some dark times, but we're going to talk about some darker times as we get into the fourth seal on that. Okay, I hope this has been enlightening in some way to you as we get a little bit further into the study of Revelation. Thank you to all of those of you that tuned in tonight and were watching to us. We'll get you next week. Now let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for the privilege to open your word, to read it and to study it. We ask, Lord, for clarity of thought and mind as we go through this study. Ask that you reveal to us the teachings that we need to learn, we need to know, in order that we may be a stronger follower of yours in teaching and sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ to a pagan world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Bye-bye.